Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Esoteric Atlanta. Sorry, just had to fix my camera there. Of course, my name is Bryce. This is our final installment of the Octurian Anthology. Next week, we will be starting with the Great Human Potential. And actually, after we finish this book, we're going to be looking at a Barbara Maciniak book that came highly recommended. To start to look at the Palladians and channelings from the Palladians. There will be a link down in the description box below if you would like to go ahead and purchase the next book or any of the other books that we have gone through on this channel. If you are new to this channel, I know I'm picking up a lot of new subscribers. Welcome. I'm so glad that you are here. We do this on Tuesdays. You know, like in Mean Girls, they say on Wednesdays, we wear pink. On Tuesdays, we get real woo-woo and we look at a bunch of different channeling material. What started off as me just exploring the missing books of the Bible has now turned into me looking at a bunch of other work from a bunch of other people because truly, the more we learn, the less we realize we know. Thank God, too, right? Like we're in third density, and this is not really the density of knowing. It's more the density of making choices. So that means that we get to kind of entertain these ideas and these concepts that are brought to us by other people, and of course, other, if you believe in aliens, other aliens. I've thoroughly enjoyed a lot of Tom Kenyon's work. Again, the next book we are doing, The Great Human Potential, is what I believe to be the last of Tom Kenyon's books, unless anybody knows of any other books by Tom Kenyon or channeled by Tom Kenyon. Of course, we started with the Magdalene manuscript and we did the Hathor material, and now we're doing the Octurians. And so I thoroughly have enjoyed a lot of his work. There are some things that as you guys know, that I don't agree with what he says, but that's okay, right? Like as I said on my last video with Catherine Edwards, opinions are like assholes. Everyone's got one. Just because you don't agree with some stuff doesn't mean you can't appreciate it, and that there aren't other things that you actually do agree with Tom Kenyon's channeling. I just want to also remind you guys, I know I say this almost every episode, but when we're looking at any type of divination or channeled material, we have to realize, and this isn't just with books or anything. Anytime you're going to somebody who is channeling, right? Who is acting as a conduit from a higher source to give you information. The information is coming through the perception of the human being who is doing the channeling. And so I do believe that there is a lot that is lost in translation, meaning that when somebody is receiving messages from the other side, they're filtering it through the realms of their reality. And reality is perception and their confirmation biases. So you always have to take everything with a grain of salt. This isn't a conspiracy. Like people aren't, well, yeah, we know that there are bad channelers out there that are absolutely trying to manipulate you, but that's not the same for every channeler out there. It's not a conspiracy. It's just people are literally taking the information through the lens of their own perspective. And so with that being said, if something doesn't resonate with you, then leave it. That's fine. It doesn't mean that the whole book or the whole work has to be thrown out. Just understand that there's going to be confirmation biases. There's going to be some stuff lost in translation. So with that being said, if you're new to the channel again, I will put the playlist, Understanding the Magdalene, where all the parts of this channeling are located in that playlist. We also have the Sophia Code. We also have the Return of the Divine Sophia, the Magdalene Manuscript, the Hathor material. Megan Watterson's commentary on Magdalene's Gospel. That's what we started with this playlist. So there's a ton of stuff down there that I have thoroughly enjoyed. I do always suggest that you get your own copy of these works. I do give commentary on these works, but my opinion should in no means be fact for you. You need to do your own research, come to your own conclusions. It's always awesome. I love hearing people's commentary because it helps me see different perspectives of a topic that maybe I wouldn't have seen if I hadn't heard somebody else's opinion. And that's all this is doing for you, the individual. Again, in the link below for the next book, it's a link to my Amazon list. And in that particular books we used on the show, category has all the books that we used up to this point, so that you can always reference back and get these books for yourself for your own library. I do read everything. So for those of you who are not in a financial position to be able to afford to purchase these books, you can always, I'm not taking these down. If any videos come down, it's the platform that's taking them down, not me. So you can always go back and re-listen. So today we're actually doing the epilogue, which is basically Tom Kenyon's perspective on everything that he has learned going through this communication with the Octurians. But as always, before we get into this reading, I do want to give a very, very special shout out to our sponsors, ASEA. I'm so incredibly grateful for ASEA because they are what make, ASEA and my patrons are what make this channel possible. They are what is allowing you to watch this channel for free. So before we get into the readings, just a brief word from our sponsors. If you've been on this channel for a while with me, you know that I am a firm believer in the power of food. The power of food being your medicine and being your spiritual source of an energy supply. After all, matter or nature is the Shakti of consciousness. It is the Shakti and the expression of the soul. If you've been on this channel for a while, you know that I very much promote a plant-based diet along with the Ayurvedic system of knowing what your actual dosha is. With that being said, in my life, in my adult life, I have tried many, many supplements before. And you guys know that I am a huge fan of the ASEA Redox supplement, the liquid, as well as the gel. But did you also know that ASEA has a vitamin line? That's right, it's called the ASEA Via. There are four different types of supplements that ASEA is offering. This one is the Source, which is whole food and micronutrient complex. They also have Life Max, which supports a healthy lifestyle. They also have an omega and they have a probiotic. Now again, with this being said, I am very much a snob when it comes to supplements. Again, I've been using supplements for a very, very long time because early on in my adult life, especially with my yoga career with Ashtanga Yoga, I realized again how important the value of nutrients were to your overall spiritual health. The body is energy and food is energy. And if we're giving our body the correct energy, just like you give your car the correct energy, the correct gas, then your body, your mind, your well-being will work better for you. Now, again, yes, there are lots of supplements out there that are frankly crap. And I was not going to actually try the ASEA supplements when I first started using ASEA because I was happy with the supplements I had been taking. But one day I was on their website and I was like, you know what? I'm actually just going to try it. I'm going to order these vitamins and I'm just going to see how I like them. My boyfriend also is the same of me. He himself is very skeptical of supplements. He's been doing supplemental work for literally 30 years now. And so for him, he too was skeptical. Well, the first supplement we got was the Source. In this supplement, it has spirulina, alfalfa leaf juice, wheatgrass juice, barley grass juice, oatgrass juice, pomegranate juice, aci berry juice, raspberry juice, blueberry juice, cranberry juice, grape juice, goji berry juice, sea kelp, broccoli, cabbage, parsley, kale, dandelion, and broccoli sprouts. It says on the box, a food-based micronutrient complex with a unique blend of superfoods, which a lot of what I just read to you is considered a superfood, as well as plant extracts and trace minerals. Now again, once I got the bottle, I was still a little skeptical. I, again, am a creature of habit, and I liked the supplement I was on. But right when I opened this, I could smell the potency of the capsules inside. I knew the minute I opened this that this was going to be good. The same thing with the Life Max. Now for me, I do struggle with inflammation because I do have a propensity to have some arthritic flare-ups. This has a lot of turmeric in it, and turmeric is nature's anti-inflammatory. Basically, it's like nature's ibuprofen. And as it says on the back, that this is designed to counter the negative effects of aging. This supplement contains natural herb Astrex, which increase energy levels, support the immune system, and promote healthy inflammatory responses, support joint health, and promote a healthy, more youthful appearance. Now, again, these two, in my opinion, are the Mac Daddies. And I will say, 2 days after my boyfriend being on these supplements, he came home from work saying that he could not believe the amount of energy he had that day. He was so impressed by the quality of, especially this one, of these vitamins, that there was no way he would ever go back to the vitamins that we were originally taking. Now, if you go to the ASEA website, which will be linked down in the description box below, you will see this little category of cell nutrition. Just click on that below and you will see all the different vitamins here. Once again, if you click on the individual vitamins, you can see more details about each vitamin. Now, as you guys know, or if you've been on this channel for a while, you know I am a vegetarian. The omega does have extracts from the fish, which obviously a lot of omega products do have fish in them, but from what I have heard, so I don't take the omega, but from what I have heard from people who do take the omega, their biggest takeaway from ASEA's omega is that they're not left with a fishy taste in their mouth for the rest of the day. Now, I personally am hoping that one day ASEA will make an omega supplement that is good for us vegetarians, just like they have done with their collagen radiance. They've made the collagen radiance vegetarian friendly. So anyway, guys, just another wonderful thing that is brought to you by ASEA. If you are interested or want more information on the vitamin line or any of ASEA's products, please text Bryce Info to 321-216-8047. Again, that's Bryce Info to 321-216-8047. If you are contacting Jay from a country outside of the United States, make sure you let him know that and make sure you add a +1 to his phone number. That is our country code. And make sure you double check that the vitamin line is available in your country. That will have to do with whatever red tape ASEA has to go through with your health and administration with your government. So just double check on that. It is available in the United States. I think it's available in most countries at this point. But again, for more information, text Jay, text Bryce Info to 321-216-8047. If you're already sold on these vitamins and you want to try them, I will put a link down in the description box that takes you directly to the vitamins, so it makes it easier for you just to quickly purchase. If 30 days goes by and you're not happy with the product, ASEA will offer you a full refund, no questions asked. All right, you guys, with that being said, back to our show. All right, let's look at the epilogue by Tom Kenyon. You live in a dualistic universe, and every perspective, no matter how elevated, has its antithesis. Ektara, the Octurian space officer, and we know that. I mean, we talk about that so much on this channel. Their density is about polarity because it's about choice. We lived in a polarized density, which means that there, for every cause, there is an effect. For every good, there is a bad. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. All right, so let's see what Tom Kenyon has to say about his experience. I've always been fascinated by words and how they came into being. In this case, I find the word epilogue most interesting, as its roots go back to ancient Greek, and the words epi, meaning in addition, and logos, meaning speech. Thus, an epilogue is a type of addition, a contemplative pause that considers what was previously said. The irony here is that I am using words to comment on a body of information about an intergalactic civilization that does not actually use words, but rather telepathic holography, a mind-boggling concept to those of us who have adapted to three-dimensional based thinking. Many of the Octurians in this anthology spoke about their use of telepathic holography directly, while others alluded to it. Yesu, the Octurian meditation master spent a large amount of his time outlining a training program to expand our capacity to consider multiple fields of information simultaneously, a precursor to telepathic holographic communication. One of the primary reasons the Acturians in this book spent so much effort clarifying the nature of telepathic holographic communication is that they have chosen to contact more human beings via what they, the Acturians, called micro tunnels of communication. According to them, their strategy to protect life, intelligence, and freedom in this sector of space is now twofold. One, the continued engagement of their starship to protect us from nefarious intergalactic interference, and two, to open micro tunnels of communication with various human beings so that more of us have access to the Acturian perspective through direct experience. In his portion of the manuscript, Frephius addressed this rationale for their decision to open up micro tunnels of communication between the Acturian civilization and humanity when he said, "It is in the nature of any action taken within the universe that counter forces arise. Thus, our strategy is to assist you in a way that does not engage counter forces as directly as they would be engaged if we were to take a direct action in your dimension of reality. In other words, the Acturians are intending to open energetic lines of communication with more and more human beings so that the collective human mind can be expanded through direct experience of the Acturian civilization. Is there hope that this indirect approach to contact will avoid the powerful counterforces that would arise should they directly enter into our third dimensional world?" That makes sense, right? Like, I know the United States government's just really announced that aliens exist and most of us just don't even care. We're like, yeah, no shit. But it makes sense, right? Like if a spaceship were just to kind of publicly land, it would put us into turmoil, right? So that makes a lot of sense. Another factor is that it takes tremendous energy, according to the Acturians, for an Acturian spaceship to enter into and leave third dimensional space, a sobering task they don't take lightly. Several of them commented that they could and would enter this world if needed, but only under the direst of circumstances. But there is a shadow side to opening micro tunnels of communication, and it is to this topic that I now wish to turn our attention. The delineation of this topic, i.e. the shadow side of micro tunnels, is my own and was only hinted at by the Acturians. But having worked in the field of Ericksonian medical hypnosis as both a psychological counselor and also as a researcher into altered states of consciousness for over two decades, I feel compelled to address the subject. For the purpose of exploring the issue around micro tunnels, I would like to divide this discussion into three categories. One, interference. Two, fantasy and delusion. And three, psychological disturbances. Interference. By interference, I mean a breakdown in the lines of communication, i.e. the micro tunnels that compromise the integrity of the information. This could be caused by an inability of the receiver, i.e. you, to attain the altered brain state required for the micro tunnel to be established and or sustained. In my experience, this type of interference can be handled through repeated experience. In other words, opening and sustaining a micro tunnel is essentially a learned brain skill. And the more you do it, the better you will be at it. Makes sense. A second type of interference, however, arises from the contamination of the inflow of information through the micro tunnel due to external force. And this is due to a mismatch in vibratory rates. It was Frephius again who addressed this issue head on when he said, "You need to understand that in order to receive accurate information, your consciousness, some might say your energy field, must vibrate to the same vibratory rate as the communication itself. This locks in the tunnel, meaning that it stabilizes and interference is greatly diminished. If, however, your consciousness or energy body is not a match to the vibratory rate of the communication, it is possible for other beings to contaminate the communication. The Cassiopeians speak about this too. There are a lot of people out there who are divinating away, thinking they're speaking to a higher density being of the light when they are actually speaking to a higher density being of the darkness who is mimicking the light. So very important. Very, very important here. It is here that we enter a truly bizarre inner terrain. And I would suggest you put that imaginary box by your side as we enter further into this discussion. The central idea is that your emotional tonality, your mental emotional state, affects the type and quality of information you receive during altered states of consciousness. If you open a micro tunnel when you are in an emotional funk, you might very well get some funky impressions and information. Furthermore, there seems to be a whole group of beings that masquerade themselves as higher dimensional beings when they are not. I call these creeps, interdimensional tricksters, and they should be avoided. The best way to bypass this kind of interference is to engage some type of energetic protection. The meditation master Esu addressed this directly, and I would strongly suggest that if you choose to experiment with opening micro tunnels of communication, that you first master Asu's method for protection, which he describes in his section of Nakura, meditation for the purpose of entering other dimensions. I do not make this suggestion lightly, by the way. I consider some form of effective energetic protection to be mandatory skill when opening micro tunnels of communication with any being. Absolutely. Fantasy and delusion. The second category is more a psychological issue than an energetic one, as in the case of interference. This type of distortion has to do with your internal agendas, hopes, and dreams. Altered states of consciousness, such as those required to open micro tunnels of communication, are prone to being affected by the unfulfilled desires of that individual. This is a slippery slope, and I have no easy answers, but I do have a few suggestions. Okay, yeah. So it's so funny. We've talked about pendulum work before, and I don't really work much with pendulums anymore. I have pendulums. Pendulums are considered to be like the kindergarten level of divination. It's like what people start with. It's not considered any form of an advanced divination. And I've spoken about this before. Pendulums read your energy. And your energy only. They do not read other people's energy. All right. And we got a lot of people out there who are swinging those pendulums, asking about things that they should not be asking with a pendulum. So if you have a question about another person, like if you want to know if this person is good or bad, or you cannot ask the pendulum that question. Because the pendulum is going to read your energy. So if you want that person to be good or bad, and then the pendulum is going to pick up on what you want, and it's going to give you that answer, right? So what he's talking about with this interference and this delusion and understanding your subconscious, you have to be very, very, very careful. First of all, when it comes to divination, you cannot divine on somebody else without their consent. It does not matter who you are. It does not matter how many years you've been doing this. Every human being on this earth has equal value to the divine. It doesn't matter if it's someone who's an atheist and someone who believes in God and has been divining for 30 years. It doesn't matter. You have no right to try. That's a spiritual assault and spiritual rape when you try to take information about a human being off of divination. It's just like breaking into somebody's house and snooping around. You do not have permission to do that. You have to seek their permission first. So what tends to happen too with the laws of the universe is if you do divine on somebody without their permission, 9 times out of 10, you're not given correct information because spirit don't play that way. And what you're getting is probably information from a negative entity, a trickster that's trying to mess you up. So when it comes to things like pendulums, what pendulum work is for you personally, for things that you don't have an emotional tie to. So let's say that you want to know what type of vitamins you should be taking. I don't have an emotional tie to vitamin C. But let's say I think I might be a little deficient. So I'm going to ask my pendulum, do I need more vitamin C? I don't have an emotional expectation of a particular answer. I don't care if I need more vitamin C or not. No emotional ties to vitamin C. So what the pendulum is going to do is it's going to pick up on my subconscious. And so it'll say yes and no. It's okay, cool. It says yes. All right, cool. I need to eat more vitamin C. That'll make me feel better. You know, I know Tamara and other people will use their pendulum to figure out which day a week they should film that week. Like if I'm going to film something and it doesn't matter which day it is, I'm going to see which day would be better from my higher self, from the pendulum. Does that make sense? So it's not things that have big indicators in your life, because when you start to mess around with that stuff, when you're using your pendulums to ask about other people, you're not going to get the correct information because the pendulum can only and will only read your energy. So if you want someone to be bad, the pendulum's going to say it's bad, right? If you are wanting something and then you ask your friend to check for you on their pendulum as your friend is probably going to say what you want it to say because they're asking, you know, it's a manipulation of energy. And so it's really important that he said that. And it's just blowing my mind. Also, you know, I've said this before, if you are working in any type of divination or any type of channeling or as a healer, you have to be working on yourself first and foremost. If you are not exercising, if you are not taking time to work through your stuff, then you can't be working with other people. That's just the foundations of spirituality. And so it's crazy to me that I'm seeing people out there who think all of a sudden they're a guru and they literally have just now discovered spirituality. It takes years to get to that point of having that knowing, right? And I want to also reiterate too, you know, we've been talking a lot about cults on this channel. And although there can be cults that are not based in any type of religion or spirituality, most commonly we see cults based around religion and spirituality because people's vulnerabilities get manipulated when it comes to your spirit and your mortality. A good spiritual teacher is not a leader. I want you to think about that. A good spiritual teacher teaches you tools from a text, from a lineage that they have learned. They teach you tools because a good teacher's job is to eventually not be needed, is to encourage you to have your own sovereignty. A cult leader's job is to always be needed. So when you take on healers, when you take on Telegram groups, when you take on any type of a teacher, ask yourself those questions. Is this person supporting me eventually doing this myself? Or are they trying to make me dependent upon them for my own salvation? Huge difference here. So really think about that. Those that are manipulating you, it's called spiritual manipulation. It happens all the time. It's a thing. I know we've talked about it before on this channel a long time ago, but you can look up spiritual manipulation. It's truly a thing. If someone's telling you that they're the incarnate of some great enigmatic figure from the past, it's bullshit, first of all, because it doesn't matter. The past doesn't matter. Right now is what matters, right? If they're trying to manipulate that, then that there's a problem there, right? That's called a pecking order. A pecking order is The dark side, the negative side. The light side is a social memory complex where everyone is equal. Teachers will exist in a social memory complex, but they don't exist as someone more important than you or more valuable than you. Teachers exist to serve you, to help you learn how to help yourself and then not be needed. I was laughing this morning with my boyfriend about how, like, I haven't been back to India in years now because of everything that's been going on, and how I kind of feel like I don't have a teacher right now. I kind of feel like I'm still kind of in this weird limbo where for the first time in my adult life, I don't have a teacher. And I was laughing because there's a really, really famous saying. It says, when the student is ready, the teacher appears. But the saying is actually not just that. There's a second part to the saying. The second part is when the student is really ready, the teacher disappears. And so I was saying, I guess I'm at that point where the teacher's disappeared and I have to integrate all this stuff, and I get to do it on YouTube with you guys. But I really, really want you guys to take that to heart. Especially, there's so many con men out there. There's so many scam artists out there. A teacher's job is to eventually not be needed. So if you are in your life taking classes or, you know, studying, whatever it is you're doing spiritually, if the person who is your helping you with this, the teacher, if they are setting you up to be able to do this by yourself, by being able to give you the tools through a teaching that can help you on your own, then you're in a healthy environment. But if that teacher is setting it up where you're dependent upon them, you're in a cult. All right? That's a pecking order. So I want you guys to really, really think about that. Okay? All right. So let's keep going. All right. First of all, you need to enter the experiment of opening micro tunnels with a good dose of sobriety and self-honesty, self-reflection. Secondly, you need to temper any information you receive with knowledge about yourself. This is, of course, tricky if you have very little psychological self-awareness. Yes. So that's what I was saying at the beginning of this. So that's that self-awareness, right? When I was saying what he's saying here, when you're filtering information, you're filtering it through the realms of your own reality, your own perception. And part of a spiritual practice, the very foundation of a spiritual practice is, as it says in the Yoga Sutras, the second sutra, Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha. That's Sanskrit, Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha. It's understanding that your thoughts, what you are thinking, aren't necessarily you and aren't necessarily true. Right? They're the vrittis, they're the survival instincts of the ego, the false sense of self. And we can't, as human beings, we can't separate ourselves from that phenomenon. So what we have to do is be aware of it. Okay? And so what he's saying here, when you have psychological self-awareness, when you understand your own personal patterns of thought, then you can digest information in a healthier way. Because you can see where your own confirmation biases lie. I hope that makes sense. If that does not make sense to you, let me know in the comment section below and we can do a deeper video on this. I hope to be talking more with Claire Headley about this, with the Scientology stuff, the reactive mind, because obviously L. Ron Hubbard got that from very old texts and he manipulated it. But there is the reactive mind. The brain, the brain, the chittam, the brain, the mind, the actual organ, that not consciousness, but the organ of the brain, it has a function and a purpose. Just like your heart and your colon and your lungs and your kidneys all have a function and a purpose in keeping you alive, so does the brain. The brain's primary purpose is to problem solve. Yeah, it's to problem solve. It's to recognize patterns and to problem solve. So thought emerges from that. We confuse that thought of the mind, of the brain, the survival instincts of intelligence with our own consciousness, which are two different things, right? As the original Christians were called Gnostics, yeah, the Gnosis, the inner knowing, and then the outer knowing, the Edio, was like the book smart. And so we're still in this battle between understanding what our Edio is and what our Gnosis is. And when you go through a strict lineage of spirituality, you start to be able, you're able to then subtly differentiate between what are the thoughts as me as Bryce and what is my conscious knowing. They're very different things here. Okay. And like when I see people who are super, 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 super obsessed with past lives and they bring that into their spirituality, I know that that is a huge red flag, that they are very confused about the thoughts and the attachments of the ego and the mind versus the conscious knowing. Yes, absolutely. I believe in reincarnation. Energy cannot be created or destroyed. It can be only transmuted. We've lived many lives. However, what I pull from a past life karmically needs to be worked through now as Bryce, right? It's past lives are interesting, nothing more. It's done. It's in the past. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter who I was in the past. What matters is what's happening in the here and now moment in this experience as Bryce. And so any karmic issues, let's say, let's pick an easy one. Like, let's say you are born with a fear of snakes and you don't know where it came. Like, there's nothing that's happened to you to make you have that fear of snakes, right? So obviously this is probably something that's coming from a past existence. Okay, fine. It's coming from a past existence, but you're experiencing that fear in this existence as who you are now. And so your job now is to sit with that fear, to lean into that fear, and to heal that fear as the person you are now. Not as the person you were in the past, that's done, but as the person you are now. Okay? And so for me, again, that's just another red flag. When I see people obsessing about who they were in the past, all of my spiritual teachers I've had and my friends who, my colleagues, I very much acknowledge past lives, very much acknowledge that, but they don't specify it. They don't say, you know, I just got finished doing the Moon of Key rites with my friend Cindy, and there was some conversation about past lives, but it's never like, ooh, let's go and let's swim in that and let's figure out who you were. No, it's like, okay, we acknowledge that there is energy that's being transferred from that existence, but that existence doesn't matter anymore. What matters is right here, right now. And so I really want people to understand that. If somebody's trying to sell you that they are some reincarnate of some big wig character from the past, run for the hills. That's a huge red flag. Because right now they aren't, even if they were that person in the past, it doesn't fucking matter. Because right now they're not. Okay? And just because somebody was some great king or warrior in the past doesn't mean anything, really. Just as you were a peasant in the past, doesn't matter. So right now what matters is this experience. All right. So that's just another thing I wanted to talk about with the psychological self-awareness. When people face difficult challenges in their lives, they sometimes look for ways out of their dilemma, especially when they feel that they do not have the personal power to change the situation or the outcome. While altered states of consciousness unquestionably offer a temporary means to escape a situation, the goal of such states, at least from the standpoint of an opening microtunnel of communication, is to empower us in our day-to-day lives by imparting to us greater understanding and subtle life-enhancing energies. Absolutely. And that's one thing I've said before, like when you are doing a daily meditation practice, you should not be sitting for longer than 15 minutes, because then it becomes an escapism. So another thing with past lives too, people who are obsessed with past lives, and it's a form of escapism. They don't want to deal with whatever they're dealing with in this life. And so they cling to this idea of past lives, right? So it's all escapism. So the point of being spiritual, the point of having a spiritual practice, it's not to avoid this life, right? It's not to avoid the uncomfortable situations that you're going to find yourself in. It's to be able to understand what those uncomfortable situations really are and know how to work through them. So if you're doing anything to avoid your life and you're labeling it spirituality, that's not spirituality, that's escapism. That's the antithesis of spirituality. Challenges that we experience in our life, if you've been on this channel for a while, you know that. That's a part of the creation of friction. Friction is necessary. The Yoga Sutras speak about this. It's not about being comfortable. You didn't come here to be comfortable, okay? You came here to be alive and to experience friction. I've said this before. If I've got a new subscriber, I want you to think about it this way. Everybody knows what a match looks like. You pull a match from a matchbook. That match, that little stick, has everything on it that it needs to light, but it cannot light unless it's struck against the matchbook. That friction is necessary. Okay, so difficult situations that we encounter, that's friction. The more your heart breaks, the more the light can shine through. Beautiful, isn't it? So I know a lot of religions will say, oh, if bad things happen to you, then maybe you're just out of favor with God. No. You came here to Earth to fuck up. That's why you came here. You came here to experience opposing forces. You're an immortal body with an immortal soul. You don't get more opposing forces than that. You came here to experience the friction of the ego. You came here to experience uncomfortable situations that forced you to shatter your false sense of perception in order to shine your light and grow. And that is the crux of spirituality, is leaning into that. Okay. In other words, micro tunnels are not about escape from reality of our lives, but rather a means to enrich us so that we can make more resourceful and enlightened choices. And it is through the act of choice making that we set the course of our destiny, not through wishful fantasy. The Cassiopeians say that wishful thinking is part of the negative side. So everyone's sitting around having wishful thinking about a med bed or wishful thinking about all this money coming to them for no reason. That's negative. That's part of the dark side. Yeah, you can't wishfully think your life away. Again, that's escapism. You have to be in your life. You have to live and lean into your life. We all the religions across the world ask the big question, right? Why are we here? Why are we here? And Alan Watts, who brought a lot of the Eastern philosophy to the West, said it's very simple. You're here to be alive. That's it. You're here to be alive. To live. You're not here to perform. You're not here to make sure you are the best accountant in the world or have the cleanest house in the world or have the best behaved children in the world. You're here to live, to experience life, to go through the heartache and the joy, to fuck up, to make mistakes. And to learn from that and to grow and to have that friction. The only thing that's expected from you, from God, from the spirit world, is for you just to be alive. All right. My advice through this issue, especially in the beginning, when you are learning how to open these energetic portals, is to take whatever impressions you received in your micro tunnel session with a grain of salt. Basically what I said in the beginning, Tom Kenyon is basically reiterating what I said in the beginning, like just take what resonates and what doesn't. Meaning don't believe what you experience without inquiry. Remember that psychic impressions are filtered through your personal consciousness. I literally said this in the beginning, and are thus subject to distortions caused by an unfulfilled desires and or fantasies. It may help immensely to keep a journal of your experiences with micro tunnels so that you can track them over time. Thus, you can glean tremendous insight and valuable information about yourself, as well as information you may be receiving from other dimensions of consciousness. Also, stay grounded. By this, I mean, don't make radical changes in your life based on any one micro tunnel experience. Absolutely. And if you encounter a being during a micro tunnel session that tells you that you must do something, especially if it's against your will or personal values, then have nothing to do with that being. I've said that before too, because you guys know I have some abilities to see things and hear things, and I have my whole life, and I've said that the same thing. Beings of light, the good beings, will never tell you to do anything that you don't want to do. They're never going to force you to do anything that you don't want to do. And they're certainly never going to give you any information about another person. So if you're channeling some being that's telling you that another person is bad and this person is good and blah, you're not channeling a being of light. You're channeling a being of darkness that's mimicking the light. Okay. So absolutely. I totally agree with this. And don't make any radical changes. Listen, Linda. I've been in the spiritual world for 17 years now. I cannot tell you how many people, and women especially, will start their practice, will start this journey into their own spirituality, and all of a sudden they need to get divorced, right? And my response, of course, you can do what you want to do, but I'm always like, just wait a moment, like take a deep breath. Don't make any radical changes right now. All these new ideas are being presented to you, all these new concepts that you've never experienced before. You're feeling a sense of liberation. You're feeling a sense of excitement about life because maybe if you came from a super religious background, you're understanding that to sin is not what you think. Sin just means to miss the mark, and that these things that have happened to you are not punishments from God, but actually opportunities to polish yourself and to have that friction. And so you're excited because you felt this new perspective, and you go and to your partner, to your husband or your wife, and you're trying to share this stuff with them, and they're not ready to hear it yet. And so all of a sudden you think you need to make a radical change where you are divorcing your spouse and all that kind of stuff. And that's not necessarily true, because over time, the teachings will settle within you, will integrate within you. And so it stops being so dogmatic, and it starts to just be a perception of life. And so you're able to maintain relationships with people that aren't on these quests, and still love them and still have joy in that relationship, because you understand that it's not about everybody understanding your perception, but you understanding your perception. You know, that being said, if you're in a marriage where there is no more love, or there's abuse or anything like that, then of course get divorced. Absolutely. But other than that, hold on. Don't make radical changes, because when you first start doing this stuff, it's going to feel like you're high sometimes. It's going to feel like you are in this honeymoon phase of this brand new way of thinking. And the honeymoon phase will wear off. And I tell my students all the time, once the honeymoon phase wears off, that's when the real practice begins. That's when the real work begins, when it starts to become normal, right? When it gets normalized. I've been doing this for 17 years. So it's normalized for me. This is a normal way of being for me. There's nothing special about it. It's just my perception. Now, in the beginning, when I first found this, I was like, oh my God, this is unbelievable, because it was so different from how I was raised. But now it's just normal. You know, I'm a very staunch vegetarian, for example. Everybody in my life eats meat though, right? Besides me, I'm a vegetarian. My yoga friends are vegetarians, but everybody else in my life is a meat eater. It is what it is. You know, that's not my prerogative to tell people how they should try to control somebody else, right? Just because I believe it's not good to eat meat because of the energetic spiritual perspective. In the Western culture, it's acceptable. And so I can't try to then control somebody else. I can only control myself, if that makes sense. You know, there's a lot of people in my lineage, of Ashtanga Yoga, that really truly believe that the only way to obtain the true teachings of yoga is through the Ashtanga practice. And even though I do agree that as far as the yoga asana is concerned, the Ashtanga lineage is the correct way because of the Yoga Karanta and the history of that, the Vinyasa flow is not offering you the same outcome of what these ancient scriptures taught. I also, as you guys see from all the shadow work challenges that we've done, believe that this philosophy, this theory, can be utilized and practiced as a runner, as a dancer. That's why in our shadow work challenges, I had you doing all sorts of kickboxing, different exercises, because you can't be so dogmatic. And these radical changes, you know, when I have students come to me and they say they want to go vegetarian, for example, they want to go vegetarian, they're ready. First of all, I'm going to tell you to go talk to an Ayurvedic nutritionist and speak with a professional. Second of all, my second piece of advice is don't go cold turkey. you have been spending your whole life eating meat. You're going to be addicted. There are things you're addicted to, and we've got to treat it as such. And so I always tell people, you know, start cutting mammals out. Don't eat cow or pig, or, you know, cut the mammals out first. The red meat, the pork, cut that out first. Go a few months without eating that. And once you get over that hump, then you can cut the chicken out. Be a pescatarian for a while and then slowly cut the fish out. Like, don't go cold turkey, because that radical change is always going to backfire. All right. Let me reread that paragraph again. Also, stay grounded. By this, I mean, don't make radical changes in your life based on any one microtunnel experience. And if you encounter a being during a microtunnel session that tells you that you must do something, especially if it's against your will or personal values, then have nothing to do with them. Finally, while I mentioned protection in the section on interference, it bears repeating. Make sure you have some form of energetic protection before opening a microtunnel of communication. In this regard, I find Isu, the Acturian Meditation Master's suggestions, both efficient and effective. Psychological disturbances. Opening microtunnels of communication is completely safe for the majority of people. But for a small number of persons, it would be contradiction, not a good idea, in other words. If you suffer from psychological imbalances such as schizophrenia, psychosis, multiple personality disorder, bipolar disorder, etc., it would be not advised to open microtunnels of communication without some type of professional supervision. I agree with that. My personal belief is that the act of opening microtunnels of communication to a benevolent higher dimensional being can have psychologically healing effects. But if you are psychologically distressed to begin with, this should be done with an experienced professional. If you are such an individual and you wish to experience these microtunnels, I suggest you find an enlightened therapist, perhaps one trained in transpersonal psychology, to be your ally. Sometimes these types of counselors will use the term spiritual-based psychologist or spiritual counselor. If you engage the assistance of such a person, make sure that he or she has good credentials and is actually experienced in dealing with psychological issues, and their relationship to transpersonal, i.e. spiritual experiences. Have him or her read this book and then discuss how to proceed or not. This is super important, guys. I say that even if you don't have psychological disturbances, you always need to ask any healer, any teacher, you need to ask for their resume. And I appreciate it when people ask for mine. The last shadow work challenge we did, I had a guy email me and he was like, I really want to participate in your challenge, but I need to ask you your credentials. And he was like, I'm sorry if that sounds rude. And I was like, absolutely not. That's not rude. I respect the fact that you're asking for my credentials. Here are my credentials. This is my teacher. This is my degree. This is how long I have spent studying this. This is my past history. This is the workshops I've taught before. This is who I am supervised by. Absolutely. If you go to a healer and they cannot give you a resume, if they cannot tell, my teacher in India is the Param Guru, Sharath Joyce of KPJAYI of Mysore, India. He's the Param Guru of the lineage. He has a Wikipedia page, for Christ's sake, right? I can tell you, my American teacher is a man named David Garig, who I studied with long before I went to India. He was profoundly effective in my understanding of philosophy and Sanskrit, as well as the actual practice. He is one of 50 people in the world to carry a specific certification. So not only can I give you my resume, but I can tell you my teacher's resumes too, right? This is important. This is for your safety, right? Somebody who has been educated, who has had to go through testing. Yes. Testing in this, they're going to have a humility about them and they're going to understand what they're doing than somebody who's just running around claiming to be some great, big, bad spiritual warrior healer, right? Let me give you guys an example too with pricing. I am the only female in the state of Georgia to carry the credentials that I carry. I worked very hard, very proud of that. I'm good at what I do. My classes pack out. My workshops and my intensive always have waiting lists. I'm good at what I do. I'm in high demand. If you were to book me for a private lesson, it's for an hour. It's like $200. And I'm at the top of the game. If there's somebody charging you thousands of dollars, red flag. Yes, we have to be paid for our work. Absolutely. It's an energy exchange. I have to pay my teacher. But someone like me and the people I know, my colleagues, will work with you. If you want to work with us privately and you can't pay it up front, we'll work with you. Many times I give people discounts if they just help me market, right? So there's these red flags you need to look for. First, what's their resume? Have them send you their resume. Have them show you. I can give you a picture of my authorization. It's in the other room. Have them give you that. What lineage are they studying? My friend Tiffany, who's a Reiki master, Emmy, who's also a Reiki master that you guys know on this channel, they have a resume, an extensive resume, both of them. They can tell you who they studied with, how long they studied, who they apprenticed with. This is important. No one just wakes up and then all of a sudden is like walking on water and healing people. It takes time to study. What's their resume? Is their pricing normal for what they're asking? Is it within a normal range? These are things to look for. Because there are a lot of con artists in the spiritual world too. A lot of them. All right. Psycho-spiritual detoxification. I think it wise to understand that when you open micro tunnels of communication with an Octurian or any high vibratory being, you are exposing your energy body to a faster rate of speed. This is a very good thing as in the evolutionary catalyst, but in some cases it can stir things up and bring unresolved thought forms, emotions, and even uncomfortable physical sensations to the surface of awareness. I want to be very clear. Most of the time, most individuals experience direct contact with higher dimensional beings without any type of psycho-spiritual detox, but it sometimes happens. It's happened to me a lot. I usually get really tired because it pulls a lot of energy. And in the large context of self-evolution, I think this is a good thing. But if you don't understand what is occurring, you might conclude that something has gone wrong when it has not. If you experience uncomfortable emotions, thoughts, and or physical sensations after an encounter with a higher dimensional being, you might find an article I wrote on the topic helpful. You can find the article section on our website, www.tomkenyon.com, under the title Psycho-Spiritual Detoxification. In summary, I can honestly say that my contact with the Octurians over the last several years has been one of the most elevating experiences of my life. Their integrity, keen intellects, mastery of interdimensional strategy, as well as their benevolent intent, not to mention their well-honed sense of humor, makes me all the more fond of them. Whether you decide to experiment with opening a micro tunnel of communication or not is in some ways immaterial. Some of us are predisposed to being adventurers in consciousness. I like that. I definitely was predisposed to being an adventurer in consciousness. What I refer to as the Argonauts of the mind, while some of us prefer to read or hear about the other worlds of consciousness. Whatever choice you make in regard to the micro tunnels themselves, it is my assumption that the knowledge shared in this anthology will stimulate, uplift, and perhaps inspire you to live a richer life that is open not only to the outer worlds of experience, but also to the inner worlds of your being. And if that shift in perception truly occurs, then this labor will have been well worth the effort. We humans find ourselves poised at a pivotal point in human history. How it will turn out is anybody's guess. As Carl Sagan once pointed out, extinction is the rule, survival is the exception. And it remains to be seen if we will survive as a species or not. Perhaps we will, as some have predicted, destroy ourselves in some fiery Armageddon madness, or perhaps the higher qualities of our humanity, such as compassion, and generosity of spirit will be hypnotized out of us by the growing planetary mind machine. And then again, under duress, we human beings sometimes surprise ourselves. Perhaps more of us will awaken from the mind-numbing dream spell that has been cast upon us for centuries and realize that we have been asleep. And like in a lucid dream, we might awaken to find that we are the dreamers. And with that power of deep insight, we might just choose to change the dream.